Hello and welcome students. We are into the 34th video lecture of the video lecture series made on the subject of machine design, whose subject code is ME303, and the topic which we are going to discuss today is the design of a spring. Now this topic is in continuation with my previous video lecture. Previous video lecture means I have taught this in the video lecture number 24. So if you have not seen my video lecture number 24, in which I have taught you about the basics of a spring, means what are the different types of springs and what are the different terminologies which are used in a spring. All the basics related to the types of springs and the terminologies and even the materials that are used in a manufacturing of a spring, I have covered in the lecture number 24 of this subject, machine design. So if you have not watched that video lecture, you can see that video lecture, and then after you can view this video lecture. So the topic which I am going to discuss with you today is the design of a spring, part 2. And in this, we are going to study the load stress equation and the load deflection equation. All right. As far as I am concerned, I am Shri Krishna Mishra, Assistant Professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering, Suresh Gyan Vihar University, Jaipur. So before moving into the lecture, let's see what are the objectives of today's lecture. So these are the objectives, students, of the today's lecture. First, we are going to understand the load stress equation used for the design of helical springs. This is very important equation, and our first motive will be to know about this load stress equation. Then the second objective is to understand the load deflection equation used for the design of helical spring. Again, as the load stress equation is important, in the same manner the deflection that is happening on the spring when load is applied on it, that study is also important, and therefore we have to derive an equation which relates the load with the deflection, and that equation is your load deflection equation. So our second objective is to understand the load deflection equation used for the design of helical springs. Third objective is to understand about the various stresses developed in helical spring when it is axially loaded. Whenever you load a helical spring, as you can see here also in the animation, whenever you load a helical spring, it is extended, and it is not only the torsional stresses that are acting on it. There are a lot of other stresses also which have to be taken into consideration while designing the spring. So we will understand, our third objective will be to understand these stresses which act on a helical spring when it is axially loaded. Then the last objective is to design a helical spring based on a given set of data. So our last objective is that we are going to use this load stress equation and load deflection equation, and we are going to solve some numericals which are based on design of helical springs. So let's move into the discussion now. First of all, see, there are two equations which are very important in the design of helical springs. What are those two equations? The two equations are, first is the load stress equation, second is the load deflection equation. Load stress equation, as the name suggests, whenever you apply load on any spring, either tensile load or compressive load, then stress is developed on the spring. So this particular equation which we are going to derive firstly is going to give you a relation between the load applied and the stress developed in the spring. All right. Then after, the second equation is the load deflection equation. In the load deflection equation, one more relation we are going to get, and that relation is between the load and the deflection. Whenever you apply the load, stresses are developed. But if your spring is not able to resist the load, then what happens? Deflection will be there of the load. This deflection occurs of the spring, and therefore it is very important to know how much the spring will deflect on the application of load. So the second equation is the load deflection equation. All right, so first let's see what is the load stress equation. See, for load stress equation, one thing that you will have to do is you will have to open a helical spring. For example, if this is the helical spring, you stretch helical spring in such a way that it becomes like a wire. You stretch whole of the helical spring in such a way that it becomes like a wire. Means if you are stretching this spring, then it is stretched. It is stretched in such a way that there is no curl in the wire spring now. There is no curl in the wire now. As there is here, you can see curling is there. Alright. So here stretch, put effort on the wire of the spring in such a way that it is becomes fully straight. Now if someone asks you what will be the total length of this spring, what will be the total length of this spring, then what will be its length? It's very obvious that here, as I have already told you in the nomenclature, in the terminologies that is used in the spring, that the diameter of the coils in which the spring has been made, the diameter of the coil, that is known as the coil diameter. All right, so capital D is basically your coil diameter, this particular diameter. Now when you will open the spring, if there are number of coils equal to capital N, if the number of coils are equal to capital N and one coil has got the diameter capital D, then it is very obvious that circumference of one of the coil will be equal to pi D. And if there are N coils, if there are N coils in the spring, then the total circumference, means the total length when you will stretch the spring, will become equal to pi D N, will become equal to pi D N. Alright, so the total length is equal to pi D N. Again, what we are doing, we are putting bracket here and here. On the initial and the outside portion, see here in the spring also the last portion which is used for resting the spring on the support, that is a type of bracket. Alright, so that bracket we are considering here, and we are taking the length of the bracket equal to half of the diameter on both the sides. And when you have stretched, it is very obvious that you have stretched, then effort will be, for getting the curl of the spring, the load that is acting, which you have to prevent from acting, is the load on one side of the bracket, the load is going in the clockwise direction, and on the other side of the bracket, it is going in the anti-clockwise direction. The same is shown here in the diagram. Here you can see it is moving somewhat like this. This bracket is moving. This bracket has got the load which is trying to move it in the clockwise direction, and here in this bracket the load is trying to move the bracket in the anti-clockwise direction. Alright, and we are taking the length of the bracket equal to, it is very obvious that length of the bracket we will take equal to how much? It will be equal to half of the diameter. So L we will take, L length of the bracket we will take equal to half of diameter. Alright. Now let's I hope you have understood the terminologies, and one important terminology is the wire diameter, the wire which is used to make the spring, that is the wire diameter. So the diameters, diameter or the dimensions of equivalent bar are as follows. See, we have stretched whole of the spring. We have stretched whole of the spring, and it has become a bar. It has become a bar, circular bar. Alright. And the diameter of this circular bar, will be equal to wire diameter. This will be equal to wire diameter, which we are denoting by small d. Alright. So the same is written here, that the diameter of the bar is equal to wire diameter of the spring. Very obvious. Then the length of one coil is in the spring is equal to pi d, as I have already explained, and there are n active coils. So this means that the total length of the equivalent bar which has been made by stretching the whole of the spring will be equal to pi d into n. So the total length which we are getting, student, of this bar, it will be equal to how much? It will be equal to pi d into n. This will be the total length of this equivalent bar. Now the bar is fitted with bracket at each end. This bar is fitted with bracket at each end. Here and here, both sides, there is bracket. Here also it is bracket. Alright, and here also there is bracket in which the load is acting in the opposite directions. Alright, and the length of the bracket, how much we are taking? It is very obvious. It will be equal to half of the diameter of the spring. Means half of the coil diameter of the spring. So it will be equal to d by 2. Here it will be equal to d by 2 on both sides. Here also and here also. Now the force P acting at the end of the bracket, this force P, as I have told to you, it is acting where? It is acting here, here and here. This force P which is acting at the end of the bracket, what will happen? This force P is trying to induce torsional shear stress in the bar. And the value of the torsional and due to this torsional shear stress, the moment, torsional moment M which is developed will be given by, it is very obvious, torque or twisting moment is given by the load into distance from the center of rotation. So this bracket, if you are applying load at the end of the bracket and this bracket has got length d by 2, then P into d by 2 will give you torsional moment. P into d by 2 will give you torsional moment. Alright, and torsional shear stress, what about torsional shear stress? It is very obvious, we all know equation of the bending equation or twisting equation, we all know the twisting equation, and according to it, we have the relation that torsional shear stress tau 1 will be equal to 16 MT upon pi d cube. This relation we all know that the twisting moment for a circular shaft, is given by pi by 16 tau d cube. Alright, how we have arrived into this equation? As we all know that we already have a torsional equation which says that T by J is equal to tau by R, where T is your twisting moment and J is your polar moment of inertia. So for a circular bar, the polar moment of inertia value we have put, and R we have taken equal to D by 2. R is equal to your D by 2. So putting R is equal to D by 2 and J equal to how much? J is equal to pi by 32. Alright. Pi by 32 D to the power 4. Now when you will cancel out, 1 D will get cancelled out. Alright. And this 32 will become equal to 16. Alright, so the final equation you will get for twisting moment as pi by 16 tau d cube. So using this equation here, this means that tau will be equal to 16 t upon pi d cube. The same thing I have written here, in the place of t I have written m, and in subscript for twisting moment I have written small t. So don't get confused by this derivation. Basically here mt is your twisting moment. Alright, so 16 mt upon pi d cube. And now this again you can rewrite. This again you can rewrite because you have the value of twisting moment equal to PD by 2. So PD by 2, putting value here, what will be the value of the torsional shear stress? It will become equal to 8 PD upon pi D cube. It will become equal to 8 PD upon pi D cube. Now students, when the equivalent bar is bent in the form of helix, when this equivalent bar of which we are studying the torsional shear stress, when it is bent in the form of helix, what happens? There are not only the torsional shear stress, there are other additional stresses. This is very important. There are other additional stresses which develop on account of two factors. Which are the two factors due to which there are other stresses which develop in the spring when you make a spring from a bar? See, the stresses are, one is the direct or the transverse shear stress in the spring wire. डायरेक्ट और ट्रांसवर्स शियर स्ट्रेस इन द स्प्रिंग वायर. ठीक है, ऑल राइट. सो डायरेक्ट स्ट्रेस विल बी डेवलपिंग इन द स्प्रिंग वायर. द सेकेंड इज द वायर इज बेंड इन द फॉर्म ऑफ अ कॉइल. सो इट इज वेरी ऑब्वियस दैट द इनर फाइबर ऑफ द कॉइल, इफ यू सी, लेट मी ड्रॉ अ डायग्राम एंड मेक यू एक्सप्लेन दिस थिंग. दैट फॉर एग्जाम्पल, इफ यू आर मेकिंग अ कॉइल फ्रॉम अ वायर, ऑल राइट, what will happen, these inner fibers, you will have to bend more, these inner fibers of the coil, they are bent more as compared to outer fibers. These inner fibers, let me show by this green line, this inner fibers, they are stressed more due to bending of the bar in the form of coil. So it is very obvious, we can say it, that the length of the inner fiber is, since it is less than the outer fiber, thus we can say that when bar is bent in the form of a coil, there is more stress concentration at the inner fiber of the coil. Alright. Whenever you will bend a wire in the form of a coil, inner fibers will be stretched more. So I hope you have understood this. So this is one of the stress which we will have to take into account, apart from the torsional stress which was acting on the bracket. And one was the direct stress. It is very obvious that whenever you will load, there will be some direct stress also that will be acting on the spring. All right, so moving further, as you can see here also, it is very obvious that in this animation, whenever the spring is stretching, it is very easy to understand there is a torsional stress that is acting, and there are also direct stresses which are acting. All right. Now, student, the resultant stress due to these two other stresses, and one stress which we have talked about, that is the torsional stress. So the torsional shear stress, the direct shear stress, and the additional stress due to curvature effect, which I have told to you, due to this curvature effect, what happens, the inner fibers are stressed to larger extents. This you can see and understand from this diagram also. The first diagram, the first one from this A part, this is explaining you the effect of pure torsional stress. So according to pure torsional stress, we know that the center axis of the bar, which is known as the neutral axis, that will not be stretched at all. All right, and as you go away from the center of axis of the bar, the stress will increase evenly. Only its nature will change. So this can be shown by this diagram. Then, if there is direct stress, we all know direct stress is same everywhere. So we can draw a diagram like this for a combined torsional curvature effect and direct shear stress. We can show in this way that the inner fiber, they are stretched to a larger extent, and due to the other two effects included in it, somewhere you will get diagram like this. All right, so now the equation which I was saying to you, torsional shear stress is equal to 16 mt upon pi d cube. All right, in other words, we can say after putting the value of twisting moment, it reduces to 8 pd upon pi d cube. Now, it does not take into consideration the effect of direct shear stress. This we have derived taking into account only the twisting moment. All right, so it does not take into account the direct shear stress and stress due to curvature effect and stress due to curvature effect. So now what we will do? This equation cannot be directly used in design of a spring. We will have to modify it. This equation, this torsional shear stress equation, this has to be modified. And for that, we will assume the following two factors to account for these effects. The two factors which we will use in order to account for these two factors are Ks and Kc. Ks and Kc. Now, what are these two factors? These two factors are, first of all, let's talk about Ks. Ks is the factor to account for direct shear stress. Alright. So this will account for direct shear stress, Ks, and Kc will account for the stress concentration due to curvature effect. Which I have told to you, explained to you just in the previous slide, that whenever you bend
a bar in the form of a coil, what happens? The inner fibers are stretched more, and therefore the stress in the inner fibers are large, and this is what? This is the stress concentration due to curvature effect. Now, if we want to combine these both effect, one due to direct shear stress and the other due to curvature effect, then the final equations become equal to, the combined factor will become equal to K is equal to Ks into Kc. We write like this, K is equal to Ks into Kc. K is equal to Ks into Kc. Alright. Now the direct shear stress in the bar that is given by this equation. We all know that a direct shear stress, how we use to calculate direct stress? Direct shear stress will be given by load upon the cross sectional area. And load is basically that is acting on the bracket, it is given by capital P, and the cross sectional area will be written as pi d square by 4. So this P upon pi d square by 4 will give you direct shear stress, to which we are writing tau 2. Now putting this 4 will go into the numerator, it will become equal to 4 P upon pi d square. Alright, and this 4 P d square upon pi d square, we can simplify for our further benefit, we can simplify this and we can write it in this way, 8 pd upon pi d cube into 0.5 small d by capital D. Why we have written this? Because you can easily see that this small d and this is small d, this will get cancelled out and finally you are getting d square. Second, 8 is here and here it is 0.5. 0.5 means what? 0.5 means it is equal to half. So this half, 2 in the denominator and 8 in the numerator, you will cancel out and you will get equal to 4. So it will finally reduce to 4 pd upon pi d square. So due to our benefit, in order to use it further, we have simplified and written this 4 p upon pi d square into 8 pd upon pi d cube into 0.5 small d by capital D. All right. Finally, the resultant shear stress can be written as the one was 8 pd upon pi d cube, and the second which we have calculated just now, it is equal to 8 pd upon pi d cube into 0.5 small d by capital C. So we are adding these two stresses and we will get the resultant shear stress. So what will become, what it will be? It will become something like 8 pd is there. Here also 8 pd is there. We have taken that common and on inside it we have 1 plus 0.5 small d by capital D. Now this particular thing, 1 plus 0.5 d upon capital D, this particular thing, 1 plus 0.5 small d upon capital D, we are giving it a name, it is your shear stress correction factor. It will be named as shear stress correction factor. It is what? It is basically your shear stress correction factor. Alright, so finally now the equation, this equation of the resultant stress, it gets simplified into tau is equal to Ks, Ks is your correction factor, alright, into 8 pd upon pi d cube. Tau is equal to Ks into 8 pd upon pi d cube. Now here one more thing we can do, then this Ks, for calculation of Ks we can write, since here it is small d by capital D. So small d by capital D, we all know that capital D by small d is your ratio. Alright. So this is capital C. We can write it by capital C. In the video lecture number 24, I have told you about the various types of terms which are used. So there I have told you about this ratio also. Alright. So now students, one more thing that is important here is that this KS, KM Wolf, this is the scientist, and he derived the equation for resultant stress, and one benefit he did, one extra thing he has added in that equation, and that is what? He included, though we have torsional shear stress and direct shear stress, two things we have already included in the previous slide. One thing was missing, stress concentration due to curvature. So what he did, he consolidated whole of the equation into this form. Now here he used a factor which is known as the Wall's factor or stress factor. It was denoted as K, and if you want to calculate it, you can calculate it by this. K is equal to 4C minus 1 upon 4C minus 4 plus 0.615 upon capital C, where capital C is what? Capital C is the spring index. Capital C is what? Capital C is spring index. Alright. So this is the consolidated final equation, which is known as the stress load stress equation, because it is giving you a relation between the load and the stress that is developing. All right, and in this a factor is there which is known as the wall factor or the stress factor, which is noted by capital K, and capital K is equal to 4c minus 1 upon 4c minus 4 plus 0.615 upon c. C here stands for spring index. All right, keep this equation in mind. This is the final consolidated equation, and it is also known as the load stress equation. All right. So this was your load stress equation, students. Now moving and let's understand what is load deflection equation. Load deflection equation. Now for load deflection equation, first of all, what we are going to attain from this equation. See, whenever load is applied on the spring, for example, this is the cut section of the spring and you are applying a load on it. What will happen? It will deflect. It will deflect from its original position. So if you want to calculate this deflection, and if you want to find a relation between the load and this particular value of deflection, then for that you will have to derive an equation, and the same equation is known as your load deflection equation. So first of all, we all know that according to the equation, according to the torsion equation, we all know that T by J, twisting moment or torque is by J is equal to T by J is equal to G theta modulus of velocity by L. Alright, so using this particular equation, which is known as the torsion equation, what we will get, this theta can be written as TL upon J. Alright, if you have used the word capital T for the twisting moment, then it is okay, but here we are using it as M. So we are writing in place of this for twisting moment, we are using the notation MT. So MTL upon J, this will give you the value of angle of twist, theta. Theta is basically what in this equation, in this torsor equation. If you don't know about this equation, you can refer my video lectures of mechanics of solid. In that subject, I have thoroughly discussed about this equation in one of the video lectures. So for now on, directly I am using this equation theta, which is angle of twist, can be obtained by theta is equal to MTL upon J. Now here MT is what? Twisting moment, and that is your PT. P, this is the load, and radius of rotation is what? This length, this is what? This is your D/2. So PD/2, this is your MT. So in place of MT, we are writing PD/2. And L is what? L is very obvious, that value will stretch, the complete length will become equal to pi dn. So we are writing in place of L equal to pi dn. And J is your polar moment of inertia. Again, the same value, pi/32 d to the power 4. This is the polar moment of inertia. Now putting these all values, students, putting these all values, simplifying it, what we will get? Some of the terms will get cancelled out. Pi, it will get cancelled out. And this 2, it will convert this 32 into 16. 16 will go in the numerator, and finally you are getting theta is equal to 16 PD square N upon G small d to the power 4. Theta is equal to 16 capital D square N upon G small d to the power 4. This is what? This is the expression for calculating the angle of twist. Now again, we will simplify it further. We also know that if you want to calculate the deflection, let's consider a very small case, this particular portion. Let, for example, this bracket is twisted by an angle theta. Alright, this length we all know it is equal to D/2. So in this mini triangle which we are getting here, for considering this small portion, in this mini triangle which we are getting, in this mini triangle, it is very obvious that this angle it will be equal to theta, and we can calculate from this particular diagram, this will be equal to delta. So it will be equal to what? We can write that tan theta is equal to del by d by 2. This means that del can be written as tan theta into d by 2. And for a small angle, student, you all know that tan theta is equal to theta. So in place of tan theta, we can write equal to theta. So obviously what you will get? You will get this deflection del is equal to theta into what? theta into length of bracket to which we are writing d by 2. Alright, so the final expression becomes something like this, which is I have written here, theta is equal to delta is equal to del is equal to theta into length of bracket, and finally your del is equal to theta into d by 2. D by 2 is the length of bracket. From this is particular mini portion of this particular spring, we have derived this equation. Putting the values, theta we have calculated already here. So from here we are using the value theta is equal to, putting the value of theta is equal to 16 pd square n upon g d to the power 4. What we will get? We will get the deflection equation like this. We will get the deflection equation like this. Alright, del is equal to 8 pd cube n upon g d to the power 4. G d to the power 4. Alright, this is the load deflection equation. This is what? This is the load deflection equation. And that particular equation in the previous slide which I have derived, that was the load stress equation. Again, from this load deflection equation, we can calculate the value of rate of spring. How? We know that rate of spring is what? It is the ratio of load per unit deflection. What is the spring rate? Spring rate is your load per unit deflection. So load P and deflection already in the here, the expression is given to you, 8 pd cube n upon g d to the power 4. So putting this particular value of deflection here in this equation of rate of spring, this rate of spring equation will simplify and it will become equal to g d to the power 4 upon 8 d cube n. This is what? This is the rate of the spring. This is what? This is the rate of the spring. So I hope you have understood. These are the terminologies which I have used while deriving the angle of twist. Alright, theta was your angle of twist, mt was your torsional moment, l the length of the bar, and j is the polar moment of inertia, whose value was pi d to the power 4 upon 32. I hope you have understood this derivation. And now one more thing that will be asked in the design of spring numericals, and that is the energy stored in the spring. So for calculating the energy stored in the spring, what you will have to do, for example, if this is the diagram between the load and the deflection. Alright, so the area under this load deflection line, for example, you are getting graph something like this. So the area under this line will give you the value of energy stored in spring. This will give you the value of energy stored in spring. This will give you the value of energy stored in spring. And how you are obtaining it? You are obtaining it by the formula, since it is basically the area under the load deflection line, is energy stored in the spring is given by what? It is given by the area under the load deflection line. And area of this triangle, it will be equal to half into base into the height. Base is your what? Base is giving you deflection value, and height is your load value. So basically half into P into del. This will give you the value of energy stored in a spring. So directly in the numericals, we are going to use the formula half into P into del is equal to energy stored in the spring. Now, basically design of helical springs. Whenever we do design of helical springs, we have got three objectives that we have to fulfill. We have to fulfill three objectives. What are those three objectives? The three objectives are: first objective is the spring should possess sufficient strength to withstand the external load. Your spring which you are designing, it should have sufficient strength. It should have sufficient strength in order to bear the external load. So first is the strength criteria. Second, it should have required load deflection characteristics. Second is that spring is basically used for what? Spring is used for storing energy when it is deflected. So the second is the load deflection characteristic, means how much deflection is occurring on the application of how much load. So the relation between load and deflection, that is important. So the second important objective of designing of helical spring is the load deflection characteristic. And the third is that it should not be that spring on the application of load, it is getting buckled. Buckled means if it is buckling like this on the application of load, if this is the axis of a spring, and see if the spring has lost its original location, it has got buckled. Alright, so if this is the problem, this should also not be the case. So therefore, in order to prevent this situation, in order to have a good load deflection characteristic and also to have a spring with sufficient strength, we design the helical springs. And designing the helical spring basically in broad sense means we are going to calculate the three dimensions. What are those three dimensions? One is the wire diameter, diameter of the wire which we are using to make the spring. For example, if you are using this spring, diameter of this wire of the spring, this is known as the wire diameter. Second is that the coil diameter, means the coiling which you are doing for making the spring, the diameter of that coil will be the coil diameter. So in the coil diameter, since if the wire that is used for making the spring, if it is thick, then in that case we will there it can have two diameters. One is the outer diameter and the other is the inner diameter. So we will use the mean diameter. We are going to calculate the mean diameter of the spring. Alright, the third is that first wire diameter, second mean coil diameter, and the third is the number of active coils. Third is what? Third is the number of active coils. Means all the coils, as I have already told you, all the coils of the spring, they don't assist in bearing the load. They don't assist in bearing the load, withstanding the load. Only a few of the coils are used for bearing the load. The one, generally the first and the last one, means the extreme two coils of the spring, they are used for getting, for positioning the spring at the support. So the third important thing that we will have to design is the number of active coils. See, the first two we are going to calculate, the first two we are going to calculate by the load stress equation, while the third one, which is the number of active coils, we are going to calculate by the load deflection equation. Now let's have a look on the design procedure. So before that, one more thing that is important you should have in your mind is that generally in design of helical spring, the permissible shear stress value which is taken is 30 to 50% of the ultimate tensile strength. The permissible shear stress value is generally taken as 30 to 50% of ultimate tensile strength. So we can write the tau value which we are going to take, the permissible value, it will be equal to 0.3 to 0.5 of SUT, 0.3 to 0.5 of ultimate tensile strength. Alright, let's have a look on the procedure which we are going to follow in the design of helical springs. See, the first is, for a given application, estimate the maximum spring force and corresponding required deflection of the spring. So first we are going to estimate what should be the, what will be the maximum spring force that will be acting on the spring and what will be the corresponding deflection that should be happening on the spring. So in some cases, maximum spring force P and stiffness K, which is P by delta, are specified. Now what we are going to do in the second step, we will select a suitable spring material and find out what is the ultimate tensile strength of the spring material. Third will be, in the second step itself, we are going to calculate the permissible shear stress. As I have already told to you, the relation between the permissible shear stress for a spring wire with the ultimate tensile strength of the material is equal to tau is equal to 0.3 SUT, ultimate tensile strength, and 0.3 to 0.5, any value we can take. Now the third step is, we are going to assume a suitable value of spring index. We are going to assume a suitable value of capital C. For industrial purposes, spring index varies from 8 to 10. A spring index of 8 is considered to be a good value. Alright, and spring index for spring in valves and clutches is taken as 5. So based on the application where the spring will be used, spring index is considered. Generally on an average, 8 value, spring index value of 8 is considered as a good value, but for industrial application it can vary between 8 to 10. But even if you talk about the spring that is used for valves and valve and clutches, the spring index generally value is taken as 5. But one thing you should keep in mind, that spring index value is never less than 3, otherwise there will be the problem of curvature effect which I have already told to you. The fourth step is, we are going to calculate the wall factor. Wall factor relation we have already seen in the load stress equation derivation. This is the wall factor, K is equal to 4C minus 1 upon 4C minus 4 plus 0.615 upon C. Then the fifth step, if a wall factor is calculated, then Let's move and calculate the stress that is acting on the spring. The formula is, this is the load stress equation of a spring. Tau is equal to K into 8PD upon pi D cube. This is the load stress equation. Tau is equal to K into 8PD upon pi D cube. Whereas, after the calculation of this wire diameter, we are going to find the mean coil diameter because we have the value of spring index. So, spring index, if we
So after this student, next we are going to calculate, after the calculation of wire diameter, coil diameter, the next step is to calculate the active number of coils. So as I have already told you, this is calculated by the load deflection equation. And if the wire is of made of the material steel, then we are going to use the value of modulus of rigidity value of steel 81370. Then the next step for design will be, we are going to design the style of end for the spring. Alright, and for that we already have the relations which I have told you in the lecture number 24 of this machine design subject, introductory part of this spring. So adding active coils and inactive coils will give us the value of total number of coils. The relation we all know, as per the, in the given in the question, we will use the relation as per the style of end. And solid length, if you want to calculate the next step, if in the question it is given to design fully the spring, then we can calculate the solid length. Solid length can be calculated by the formula total number of coils into the wire diameter. Then actual deflection of the spring can be calculated by this particular formula based on this particular value of the number of coils, we can calculate the actual deflection of the spring. Then, because this particular value, when we have taken this particular value, whatever solid length and whatever the number of coils which we are getting, we will round off it and we will use a value which is a whole number. Alright, so based on that particular value, we will have to again calculate the deflection. And we now in the next, in the 11th step, what we are going to do, we are assuming a gap of 0.5 to 2 mm between the adjacent coils. If there is no description of the gap between the coils in the question, then we will assume the gap as 0.5 to 2 mm. And based on it, what we will see, we have to calculate the total gap. And the relation we already know, the relation is total gap is equal to NT minus 1 into gap between adjacent coils. In some cases, total axial gap is taken as 15% of the maximum deflection. So if we could not calculate by this particular formula directly, 15% of maximum deflection will give us the value of total axial gap. Then in the last design procedure, we will determine the free length of the spring. And how we can calculate the free length? Free length is equal to solid length plus total gap plus the value of deflection. So these was all the steps which are followed. Apart from that, if you want to go deep into the design of a particular spring, then you can calculate the pitch also of the coil. How you can calculate? Formula we already know, pitch is equal to free length upon NT minus 1, where NT is the number, total number of coils. Yes. Again, moving further, rate of spring can be calculated by P by delta formula. P followed per unit deflection gives you the value of rate of spring. So by this you can calculate. Finally, all these values, you can prepare a list of spring specifications. Alright, and you can write them down. So this was all whole of the design procedure. Now let's solve some multiple choice question in order to understand our assessment of today's lecture. So let's start with a multiple choice question number one. The question is saying that when the helical extension spring is subjected to axial tensile force, the type of stress induced in the spring wire is. So we all know that the type of stress which is induced in the helical extension spring when it is subjected to axial tensile force is the torsional shear stress. Alright, among all the options, this is the correct option. Coming into MCQ number 2. Wall factor to account for direct shear stress and stress concentration due to curvature effect for helical spring is given by formula for wall factor we have already seen. This is particular A. This particular A option itself is giving you the correct value. Alright. So A is the correct option. Coming into multiple choice question number 3. The question number 3 says that the stiffness of the spring is, So the stiffness of the spring, we all know it is the ratio of force and deflection. So option D is the correct option. Coming into multiple choice question number 4, springs are used. So what is the benefit of using a spring? To absorb shock and vibration, to store and release energy, to measure force. So all three options are correct options. This means that option D, which says that for any of the above function spring is used, is the correct one. D is the correct option. Coming into multiple choice question number 5, the type of spring used to achieve any linear or non-linear load deflection characteristic is, so we all know that for a linear and non-linear load deflection characteristic, the type of spring is used is the Pallival spring. This I have told you while telling you about the different types of spring. Coming into the multiple choice question number 6, the maximum shear stress in a spring wire is induced at, so this I have explained to you, the curvature effect, the inner surface of the coil is stressed to the maximum extent. So option A is the correct option. Coming into the next one, the type of spring used to absorb shock and vibration in vehicles is, so in vehicles, the spring which is used to absorb shock and vibration is basically the multi-leaf springs because they can sustain higher load. All right. Coming into the MCQ number 8, the two springs of stiffness K1 and K2 are connected in parallel. The combined stiffness of the connection is given by, so we all know that in the case of parallel connection, this we will again discuss. We will discuss this particular topic of series and parallel connection in the coming video lectures. Right now, you can see that third one where the stiffness is added is the correct answer for the parallel connection. Coming into multiple choice question number 9, the question is saying that the end of spring which are in contact with the seat are known as, we all know these are the inactive coils because they don't support the load. So B is the correct option. The type of spring used in door hinges. So in door hinges, we all know that the door hinges have the helical torsional spring. So D is the correct option. So we have solved all the multiple choice questions, students. For today's lecture, this much is enough. And in the coming lecture, we are going to discuss the numericals. We are going to design the springs. For a reference for your self-study, you can use any of the references given in the screen. Thank you, students. Thank you and have a nice day.